Frequency Podcast Network. Stories that matter, podcasts that resonate.
Hey, it's Jordan. A long time ago, when I was first getting into podcasts, there was one that fascinated me. It was pretty popular. You might have heard about it. It's called Lore. And it explored folklore and spooky stories and mythology and all of the stories we tell, not knowing necessarily how true they are, but knowing that there's something to them and that they matter. And I loved that podcast. And I always wished there was a Canadian one, which is why a few years ago, we were so excited to bring Fireside Canada to Frequency Podcast Network because, well, it is that for Canada. It's our mythology, our lore, our history, and yeah, our spooky stories. And what we wanted to share with you today is the first in a mini-series that David Williams is creating with Fireside called Ghost Town Ghosts. Every week, for the next 4 weeks on Fireside, it started this week, David's going to be serving up different tales of terror and dread, but with the side of real history, from some of our country's countless vanished communities. This is episode one, The Avenging Skull of St. Leonards.
There was once a time when the sheltered coves and lonely islands of Newfoundland were home to hundreds of tiny, remote villages, embowered between the silent, wooded mountains and the teeming blue waters of the Atlantic. If you were approaching by sea, or if you had taken the only road out of these places, climbed the nearby hills and looked down, you would have seen a jumble of white, hip-roofed, two-story houses lining the kelpy shore and scattered across the grassy meadows. Most were perfectly square, as if a great wave had drawn from the ocean's depths and heaped upon the land enormous cubes of halite, crystallized salt, opacified by the glint of the hard sun and the lapping of the eastern wind. The dwellers of those homes were mostly fishermen and their families who relied on their skiffs and their nets, the wind and the tide, to eke out a living on or near the land lovingly known as the Rock. St. Leonards was one of those communities. Tucked away in a secluded glen in the western folds of Placentia Bay, most outsiders would find it lonely. But to the men, women, and children who lived and thrived there, it was home, full of laughter and play, bright fires and warm kitchens, pipe smoke, lively music, good food, and, of course, stories. There are three essential elements that go into the formation of folklore: community, isolation, and time. With a history of settlement dating back to the late 1700s, St. Leonards had all of these elements, and consequently, its share of magic and superstition. Children would rise each Shrove Tuesday in anticipation of the annual pancake breakfast, knowing that their mothers had baked little charms inside each one. The steaming pancakes, served with hot butter and syrup, would be distributed at random, and the charms inside would foretell what each child would be when they grew up. If a youngster found a piece of straw, for example, then fate had decided that year that they would be a farmer. A match was for the future boat builder, a coin for the wealthy business mogul. A scrap of linen went to the tailor, a nail to the carpenter. On Midsummer's Day, the children would wake before sunrise and, in the darkness, crack a fresh egg, separate the white, and drop it into a glass half full of cold water. Then set the glass carefully on the windowsill. At daybreak, the heat of the sun shining through the window would cause the egg white to rise like magic and take the form of dreams. Of sailing ships, fairy tale castles, or whatever else their minds could conceive, suspended on the surface of the water. On the rare occasion that an egg wouldn't rise, it would signal bad luck for the rest of the year. St. Leonards had its mysteries as well. A phantom steamship chugged through the eastern reach on calm summer nights. With its flags at half-mast and its stacks empty of smoke, witnesses would see the lights of its lower deck reflecting off the blackness of the water, and hear soft music drifting faintly on the wind. Just outside of town, on the road to St. Kieran's, sat Liza's Rock, the large, jagged boulder set back in the brush on the edge of Chapel Pond and opposite a thick stand of spruce, was a familiar sight for the children who walked past it on their way to and from school, and they would often stop there for a short rest, leaning against its sun-warmed surface, kicking at the blue gravel on the road, and speculating at all the ghastly ways that this lonely rock had come to bear a woman's name. The elders cautioned the children to never ask questions about what happened to the woman they called Poor Liza. Instead, they were told to say a prayer for her soul and not to linger, as strange noises were often heard in the area after dark. Further up the road, past a flowering marsh and a narrow waterfall, were the remains of an old stone church that had been gutted by fire in 1921. The children of the village were warned to stay away, a warning they readily dismissed, opting instead to play amongst the ruins, shouting and listening to their voices echo over the distant hills. On Sunday afternoons, they would linger and listen just a few moments longer, hoping that they would hear, as their parents sometimes did, the sound of the long silence sancta spell announcing the final moment of a phantom consecration. Only when the pond across the road shone red in the setting sun would they finally start for home, fearing the ghosts that were said to rise from their graves in the darkness, and the twin headless black dogs that, according to legend, would walk through the churchyard gate at twilight before vanishing in the encroaching fog. These are all fragments of stories. The phantom ship has no name or destination. Liza's story may be forever forgotten, a casualty of community taboo, and the headless spectral dogs manifest without obvious purpose. Their decapitation, an odd but not unheard of peculiarity for black dogs of folklore. The rest of their story, if there was more to begin with, is likely lost to time. Left behind like the crumbling walls of the church, landmarks for a community that no longer exists. But there is one story from St. Leonard's that has survived more or less intact from the early days of the village, though no one knows exactly when. It's a story about the past, about the dead, about the remains of things and of people who came before, and, like any good folktale, about the dangerous, sometimes deadly risk of ignoring cultural values and disrespecting what remains. You're listening to Fireside Canada, my podcast about Canadian legends, lies, and lore. I'm David Williams. I've always been fascinated by ghost towns, those places where entire communities lived, thrived, and eventually died, allowing Mother Nature to reclaim them bit by bit. Sometimes it's a fire that does them in, sometimes a flood or a plague. More often, however, it's the resource that the community was built around. The mine, the fields, the fishing grounds, the timber supply either taps out or the market shifts, making that resource not as valuable as it once was. Profit plummets, production grinds to a halt, and the people move on. But something is always left behind. A few relics in the ground, a cabin, a clearing, an overgrown path. Even when there's nothing, there's always something. Even if that something is a space where something used to be. Now, I live in BC, which is home to the highest number of ghost towns in all of North America, and it's been a hobby of mine for over a decade now to take a few days off each summer to explore some of those places and learn about their history. Sometimes, when I tell people I like to explore ghost towns, they'll ask me if I've ever seen any real ghosts on my travels, and I laugh and say it's not that kind of ghost town. But why not? Ghosts are, in their own way, a kind of memory, a small piece of the past that was left behind while the world kept moving. And it's often suggested that some spirits may linger because they have unfinished business. Ghost towns, in turn, are places where you can find a family home without a family, a church without parishioners, forgotten machines, rusted tools, and fallen cables without employment. They are, by their very existence, places of unfinished business. These former town sites, deserted camps, and abandoned rail lines seem likely spots for the supernatural. Maybe ghost towns are home to more than just relics and ruins. Maybe we can be haunted by the past in more ways than one. And that's what this episode is about. In fact, this is just part one of a four-part series that I'm calling Ghost Town Ghosts. For the next four episodes, I'll be serving up different tales of terror and dread, each with a side of history, and each from one of our country's countless vanished communities. Tonight, a simple story from Newfoundland about the dead avenging an injustice. This is the legend of the Avenging Skull of St. Leonards. Part 1. The Skull. Some will tell you it came from the sea, on account of him being a fisherman. Or they'll say it happened in the cold and dark of the fall, when the birch in the hills had been stripped by the nor'easters blowing across the bay. Fact is, he was in the garden when he found it, under a bright but tepid sun barely risen on the morning of the strawberry moon, the first full moon of June. That was the day that most in the village began planting their gardens, confident that the threat of a spring frost was finally behind them. You could walk the waterfront and see on one side the white spray of the ocean leaping high on the land wash, and the figures of children, shadows against the shining sea, searching the smooth sand for dead starfish, gull feathers, and gleaming glass floats, while on the other, waves of wooden handles of hoes, rakes, and shovels arced through the soft air as the people of St. Leonard's broke the soil and pulled up stones. The fisherman was there like all the rest, with not a fishing pole, but a garden hoe in hand. He had just unearthed a black clump of gnarled roots near the corner of his house when he brought the iron down hard once more into the soil and was surprised when the blade didn't bite. He tried again, harder, and this time he heard a hollow thack as the metal glanced off a curved object lying just below the surface, sending a buzz of vibrations rattling up his arm. The fisherman frowned, then tapped around the obstruction, exposing its edges, then dug below the rim and pulled. The earth was resistant at first, tightly packed, but a few more pulls loosened a small landslide as the white object flipped up out of its resting place and rolled near his feet. He picked it up with his free hand and chuckled in surprise. It was a human skull. He dropped the hoe and smoothed his hand over the top, then dug a grubby finger into one of its sockets and pulled out a wet clump of earth. A millipede scurried across his knuckles. The skull was as cold as a stone, and there was no telling how long it had been lying in the garden, waiting to be found. The fisherman laid an empty flour sack over the skull, then called out to his neighbors to come see what he had found in his garden. He grinned as the others gathered around him, and then pulled the sack up and away with a flourish like a magic trick, revealing the ancient skull to his unsuspecting audience. A few people gasped. Another made the sign of the cross. The fisherman beamed with satisfaction. He tossed the skull in the air, caught it upside down, and waved it proudly in front of the crowd, who stared in surprise at the grisly object cradled in his hand. Another fisherman stepped forward and put a hand out to stop him. "Jesus, what are you doing?" The grim response chased the glee from the fisherman's face. "What? That's human remains, a woman said. You don't go parading it around the village like a trophy fish. Put it back, another ordered. It's bad luck. Put it back and forget you ever found it. No, you should do it proper, a fourth voice insisted. Take it to the church. The father will bless it and give it a decent burial. The fisherman's face darkened with indignance at the reproach. He held the skull at eye level and examined it with casual indifference, the way he would look at a worm on a hook or a piece of flotsam caught in his net. It was in my garden, so it's mine. He smiled. Whoever had it last doesn't need it anymore. He stuck out his lower lip and narrowed his eyes in mock consideration. It can hold water well enough. Maybe I'll use it as a dipper. The others balked at this suggestion. They called him shameless, disrespectful, a sacrilegious fool. Such an act, they warned, seldom goes unpunished. The lecture only served to galvanize the fisherman's arrogant resolve. He set his jaw and said that they were silly and superstitious. He announced that not only would he use the skull as a dipper, he would use it that very morning on the grounds. The crowd watched in shock as the fisherman gathered his gear and, skull in hand, marched to the rocky western collar of the cove. He tossed the skull into the stern of his skiff, climbed aboard, and rowed out to sea. Word of his gruesome find and outrageous actions spread fast through the village, and for the rest of the day, the people of St. Leonard's would often look up from their work and out to sea, and try to pick out the fishermen amidst the dozens of silhouettes that moved like ghosts through the blue haze. They knew that his arrogance would invite some kind of divine retribution, but they were uncertain of what form it would take. Maybe a rogue wave would capsize his vessel, or a sudden gale would push him helplessly out to sea. Maybe, God forbid, it would be wider in focus and indiscriminate. A sudden storm could destroy his skiff and wipe out their entire fleet, or the fish so plentiful in the cove could simply disappear, condemning the entire community to starvation. They were half right. The punishment would come, but it would be issued not by the divine, but by something else, something darker. Twilight settled on the town. The mist crept up on shore. The houses pulsed with orange firelight and the nutty smell of baked trout and seabird. The sea was near empty. Most of the fishermen had come in with their catch, and the stragglers were close behind. But one lonely vessel still drifted on the horizon. It looked as if no one was aboard. It was as motionless as a cloud on a windless day. Those who had returned began to talk, wondering if someone should go to check on the fishermen. But just when the bravest of the villagers were about to cast off, the seemingly empty skiff suddenly lurched forward, turned about, and sped toward the beach without the aid of oars or sail. The self-propelled vessel cut through the purple spray and sanguine light coruscating on the ocean's surface. White foam split across its prow as it slid effortlessly into its moorage and suddenly stopped, its bow knocking against the weathered dock as if announcing its return. No one moved. A dog barked somewhere in the distance, and the knocking continued its steady, insistent rhythm drummed out by the incoming tide. Everyone had the same question on their minds, but no one dared to speak it. The skiff had returned, but where was the fisherman? After several silent moments, the crowd carefully advanced to the edge of the dock. Several gasped, one fainted, and others turned to run. The fisherman was crumpled in the bottom of the skiff, lying in a shallow pool of salt water and blood. His broken body was a patchwork of bruises, his face frozen in fear and torn in places as if it had been bitten. White flaps of broken skin frowned below red dashed lines and jagged slits smeared with dried blood. And the skull? The skull was nowhere to be found. Part 2. Out from St. Leonard's. You've probably heard a folktale like this before. The most common version is known simply as the bone, the teeny tiny woman, or cemetery soup. Whatever its name, all three stories are the same, about a woman or a family who finds a bone in a graveyard and takes it home to make soup. Their highly suspect dinner plans are aborted, however, when a thin voice wails from the darkness, "Give me my bone!" It grows louder and louder until the entire house shakes and the hapless chef finally yells in reply, "Take it!" and throws it out into the darkness. That folktale, likely of English or Scottish origin, is meant to be recited in a soft and mysterious voice until the final startling climax. It's designed to make the listener jump and to impart a valuable lesson. The dead will not suffer indignities. Of course, this story is a bit different. The lesson is the same, but the skull of St. Leonard's prefers action over words. And it's told as if it were a true story that actually happened in that community. I found the basic outline of this story buried inside a book titled Some Superstitions and Traditions of Newfoundland, first published around the year 1919. The book, written by local author and reporter P.J. Kinsella, is a mostly unorganized collection of folkloric facts, summarized local legends, and snippets of ghost stories presented in a sort of rapid-fire, stream-of-consciousness fashion that was common at the time. And he doesn't offer much in the way of introduction or background, only that, quote, "It is only fair to say, by way of preface, that the incident happened many years ago, when perhaps times and manners engendered many of the people with a recklessness of spirit toned down by later environments," end quote. I take that to mean that some of the earlier settlers of Newfoundland played a little fast and loose with mortal remains. It is the only story from St. Leonard's that the author includes in his book, and he mentions the tiny hamlet as casually as he mentions the bustling city of St. John's, which makes it all the more interesting that, less than 50 years later, the entire community of St. Leonard's will vanish almost as quickly as that legendary skull. During the warmer months of the late 1960s, there was a good chance that you could walk to the Newfoundland coast, look out over the water, and have the surreal experience of watching a family home float by, supported by empty oil drums and towed by a fishing boat. It was part of a government-run resettlement program designed to encourage those Newfoundlanders and Labradorians living in small outport villages to leave their homes and resettle within larger, more accessible communities. Most of these places had relied on the traditional salt cod fisheries to sustain them, and were built adjacent to some of the best fishing spots in the entire Atlantic. It was a family business. The men would fish the grounds from small, open boats, and the women and children would dry and salt them, before sending them to the markets of Europe and the Caribbean. It had been that way for generations, and in some communities, for centuries. But the world was changing. By the 1950s, the traditional family-based fisheries were struggling. Modern industry had come to the province, and its offshore trawlers and corporate fish plants were meeting a new demand for fresh and frozen cod shipped to supermarkets across North America. Traditional methods just couldn't keep up. The hope was that the evacuees would find new jobs in larger, more economically viable communities, what the government called growth centers. There were social reasons behind the program as well. Even by the 1960s, half of the targeted settlements were without electricity or any modern infrastructure, and many lacked indoor plumbing. Most were only reachable by boat, and people had to travel for hours to visit a hospital. So the government offered a small financial incentive to every household willing to move. But there was a catch. You would only get the money if 80 to 90% of your neighbors agreed to move too, a stipulation that caused a lot of contention within the settlements, but helped to ensure a more organized and complete transition. Between 1954 and 1975, over 30,000 people were relocated, and 250 communities disappeared. St. Leonard's was just one of those 250, but its name would eventually be immortalized in a song meant to commemorate the resettlement, along with all of the places that were abandoned and the people who were displaced. Written in the tradition of some of the province's best transitional folk music, Out from St. Leonard's by Gary O'Driscoll captures the uncertainty and the bravery of the families who left their homes in search of a better life, and who, as the chorus tells us, steamed across the bay with their houses in tow. Here's a clip of the song, beautifully performed by St. John's folk group, the Irish Descendants.
And it's out from St. Leonard's and out from Tonslow, they steam across the bay with their houses in tow, with their beds in the bow, their stoves in the stern, bound away with their sons and their daughters.
The resettlement program made it easier for thousands of people to access better education, healthcare, and other resources. But it came at a price. While some houses could be relocated, others had to be left behind. Many larger families, widows, and the elderly couldn't afford to buy new homes, and people who were previously self-sufficient growing vegetables and raising livestock had to abandon their gardens, slaughter their animals, and move to a smaller plot of land, then source from the stores what they had once grown themselves. One economic study completed in the late 1960s suggested that it would take the average household over 20 years to recover from the financial burden of resettlement, but only if they were steadily employed. And that was easier said than done. Some growth centers became overcrowded, the promise of jobs never materialized, the unemployment rate rose even higher, and some residents began to resent the newcomers. Facing destitution, some fishermen chose to commute back to the waters near their evacuated communities, to return to the only life they knew, to catch snow crabs, lobsters, and scallops. They were forbidden to return to their former homes or to occupy or construct any new buildings on the grounds, and it must have been strange to sit in the water and look at an empty shore where their home, their friends, their family, their entire world used to be, and were only rotting, empty houses, overgrown gardens, and deserted churches and graveyards remained. And then there are the things that were left behind that are harder to see. The strong sense of community, the independent way of life, the unique culture that had made each lonely outport a beloved home for so many. A culture that had its own stories. The ruins of the old stone church still stand between what was St. Leonard's and St. Kieran's, and Liza's Rock still lies moss-festooned and forgotten beside the broken road. The true story of its namesake is likely lost to time. And I wonder, now that the people are gone, if the two spectral dogs still pad through the churchyard at twilight, if that phantom ship still drifts through the reach on warm summer nights, its glowing lights and soft music unseen and unheard. And if, somewhere below the water's surface, lies a haunted skull dropped by its victim over 3 centuries ago when it exacted its final revenge. The legend of the Avenging Skull of St. Leonard's is a wonderfully chilling ghost story that's perfect for the campfire, and it offers us a glimpse into the lives and the lore of the people who once lived there. But it also teaches us the importance of respecting what came before. It's a sentiment that many have taken to heart. Even today, some families of the resettled often return to the sites of these former communities, to the homes of their parents and grandparents, to reconnect with each other and with the past, to talk about their ancestors, and to honor the dead and the hardships they endured for the land and the people that they loved. For many in Newfoundland and Labrador, that traditional way of life is gone, but its influence on the history and culture of the province and the country still remains. By keeping these memories and stories alive, we can ensure that, while the communities of St. Leonard's and other outports are gone, they will never be forgotten. That's it for this episode. Thank you so much for listening, and for joining me in becoming part of a Canadian folk tradition. Now that you know the story, share it. And remember, if you ever discover human remains in your garden, be sure to treat it with respect. Otherwise, the past might come back to bite you. Literally. Fireside Canada is written and recorded by me, David Williams, with sound design by Matt Kesselman. Stephanie Phillips is our showrunner. Mary Jubrin is our digital editor. Diana Kay is our business manager. Jordan Heath Rawlings is our executive producer. If you enjoyed this episode, please consider giving this podcast a positive review. If you want to help even further, you can provide story ideas and more through my website. Every little bit helps to keep the fire burning and the library of legends growing. Learn more at firesidecanada.ca.